It's 11:42. Welcome to Ghosting Today. Ron Nicoletti along with Pete Aiello. So beautiful day today here in South Florida. Fast main track, firm turf course, lots of great action. But what about the Stronach 5 yesterday?
Well, I've been saying it's your one-way ticket to Overlay City, but that's a little bit of an overstatement yesterday, as it was just a tough sequence to have. Two people had it, and they got paid $88,000 for their troubles, and that included a $5 winner who was even money on the morning line in Leg C.
Yeah, amazing how that pays. All the payoffs. This is, I wish I had one of those tickets. I didn't fare too well. I've had one. I think I had two of the five, so we'll say that is. And now the other exciting thing was the Rainbow Six yesterday. Someone's alive, or three people are alive, whoever it was, with the 1, the 4, and the 5, the logical three horses, along with the 8 who ends up winning it.
All I'm going to say to that is that's a bad beat story for life, and congratulations, but my apologies at the same time.
Yeah, it was a tough beat, so we'll see how that goes. And I think that's the only carryover we actually have this afternoon.
I'm going to try to keep my words to a minimum. I'm not doing it to make Ronnie have to talk more or look silly or anything. It's just that my opinion's been so bad lately, I'm struggling to even offer anything, because anything I say has been dead wrong. So if you're watching this telecast, anything I say, do the complete opposite, a la Let It Ride. And you should be all set.
And three pick fours today, too, so you got a chance to maybe get even today with those three pick fours. We offer that very exciting middle pick four every day, every weekend when we have 12 races.
I can't pick one, so four might be a little bit of a stretch. I don't think that's going to – I don't know if it's good news. It's certainly not good news for me, but if it's any consolation to any of our viewers out there, my pocketbook and wallet have taken a severe hit the last 2 days. So when I tell you something, I'm not just saying it for the sake of saying it. I'm hurting all. So I get those tweets, thanks for nothing. Well, yeah, I lost my money, too. I'm not just up here prognosticating.
Well, what a perfect way to segue into your early pick five ticket here this afternoon. So he's got four deep in here. That means you single somebody. Is that how it works?
Well, famous last words, but I put it to you this way. If I don't get out of the first leg with 2, 4, 5, 6, I think Ronnie's going to be calling the rest of the card. And if you see any paramedics on the apron, I might jump off the roof, because other than Travy Boy, who's been laid up since August. Now that you scratch the 1, the 2, 4, 5, and 6 cover the bases here. Strong single in the second race. I'm dare to say that I really like the 6 Cocktail Skirt. Raylu Gutierrez is in town, and he's not here just for the weather. This horse is well spotted and looks to me much the best horse in the second race, and you're solid single. In the third race, it's a 6-horse field. I narrowed it down to 2. I think the older horses and the class droppers rule here, with the 1, 4, the Gipper on the drop in class, and the 5, Arriva Durla on the major class. Last drop. I think you can get out of that race with just those 2. 4 deep in the 4th. That's not an easy race, but I do think those are the right 4. Somebody's going to wake up. That's just going to have to happen, because there's a lot of form reversals that need to take place for contenders in the 4th. And then 3 deep, if we get that far, I'm going to use Cryogenic, who I needed badly last time. Karen's Cove is the sneaky in that race. I like that horse at 6-1. And then Barbarossa, who does have some gate speed, but he's parked all the way on the outside. I want inside speed. I'm not going to get it, so I'm hoping I can get a trip to close the early pick 5. It's a $48 play, and before you ask, yes, I will have that. So if it hits, feel free to wish me congratulations. If it misses, I lost the same as everyone else.
Well, let's look at this first race. And the horse that I had on top is the 6 Hurricane Roberta, who's stepping up to the next level after responding to the first start back from the layoff with a victory. She beat the boys last time out in a 6,250 two-lifetime claimer. She's right back trying to beat the boys again for Rohan Crichton with Jose Bautista and the Irons.
The question I have is twofold with this horse. Number one, yeah, I get trying to beat the boys last time, because it was a non-winners of 2, but is this a calculated move, and they actually figure that the lifetime conditions at this level are cheaper for the males than the fillies, or are we just not making the filly version of these races? If anybody in the racing office knows that, feel free to let me know.
Yeah, I mean, you did go with Dr. Harlan on top, who moved to the Gustavo Delgado barn after the claim and returned from the layoff. He really got mugged at the half-mile pole last time out.
He sure did, so you can draw a line through that last race. That's the good news. The bad news is I don't have an excuse for the race 2 back, and he's really going to have to reverse his form. But if anybody can do that, it's jockey Edgar Zayas and trainer Gustavo Delgado. There's not a whole lot of dedicated speed in here, Ronnie. I think the 2 Ebrio moves up with the scratch of the 1, but Dr. Harlan could get a much better spot early than he has lately.
Yeah, he looks like a major player, and he just needs that clean trip and close it out. I had a tough time finding anybody to finish my try or super in there.
Well, I finished it out with the 5, Cotton 2, who, again, will need some pace to chase. His race, 2 backs, plenty good enough to win, but I don't know that he can get that kind of trip. Well, I'm safe, 2, 4, 5, 6, although you have the 7, so that's just...
Yeah, the 7 just when I threw in there, but I really like the 4 and the 6 in that race. So let's go to race number 2. Mile on the Turf, claim his fillies and mares, 3 end up, non-winners of 3 in life, or 3-year-olds, 12-5. And you mentioned Cocktail Skirt as your single on your early pick 5 ticket.
To me, she just looks too good. Her race 2 back wins, her race last time wins, her race 3 back wins, her race 4 back is not probably a winning effort, but close enough. You get the picture. She has it to throw away in this race. Raylu Gutierrez in town for the call. Pace-wise, she should be fine because she does have enough tracking speed where she can get into position 5 or 6 lengths off the lead. She's not going to be, you know, 15 behind or anything. And there's not a lot of speed in here either, so she'll be able to get in a good striking spot. I think the 7 cuts the pace in here. My masterpiece. I needed her something bad last time. She ran really well. I'm not sure she gets the hassle-free lead that she does last time here today.
Well, going back to Cocktail Skirt, let's show you a stat on Mr. Mike Makeup. With a 50% drop in claiming price on the turf, he's 7 for 30, 23%, 57% in the money. $1.95 is the return of investment. Yeah, my masterpiece, stretching out slightly, set the pace, just got nailed at the wire that day, so I guess it hurt you. And that
it
was
did.
Going that was going 7.5. I split them with the horse you have in third, Liberale. The French Bread is another dropping to this level today. Dual for lead, finished third behind Cocktail Skirt when they hooked up for 25 last time out. So sort of all these guys banging heads again together. So whatever the claiming price is, I believe that Cocktail Skirt is the one to beat.
Well, the thing that makes me feel better about Cocktail Skirt, because she is theoretically taking a major class drop, but so is the 9. And I don't think, to me, it's an anomaly if 2 horses are dropping that
That's
much.
What I meant.
It's just, this is the race they belong in. And if you look at the condition book, this is the race they need to be in. That's the race they're in. And they both have a good shot. Liberale doesn't win as often as Cocktail Skirt. Of course, that's a bit of a stupid statement because this is 9 winners of 3. But put it to you this way. The 9 has had more chances at this level than the 6.
Well, let's go to race number 3. 6.5 furlongs. Claim is 3 and up. Non-winners of 2 races in life or 3-year-olds. 12-5 is the condition. And you have on top the number 6, Goiza.
No, I don't.
Oh, no, you know. Oh, you have the 5 like me? Oh, yeah, you
have the 5 like I don't like the 6 at all here.
Well, you want to show the course
right.
last race.
That's right. That's why I want to show
you. So maybe you had it on top for that reason.
No, this is a trip of a lifetime. If you think this horse is going to get this trip today, go ahead and bet. I don't. Number 2, Goiza got a beautiful run through. I mean, this horse is near the back of the field. And, oh, by the way, he's 33-1, so it's not like he's going to be supposed to do this. He just rides the rail all the way into contention. He moves up 3 spots. Now, watch this. Oops, got inside of the 4 there. Now all of a sudden, Goiza went from last to 3rd without having to spend a penny, as they would say across the seas. And now this horse has secured the rail, and at this point, the race is over. At 33-1, Goiza was a winner at the top of the stretch that day, and he got a perfect run to do it. Now, can he do that again? I don't think so, because his races 3, 4, and 2 starts ago are terrible. So this was a perfect trip. He made use of it. Show me he can do it again at 5-2 on the morning line. No thanks.
Well, you know, the same jockey will be aboard, so Sammy Camacho, right? So we'll see how he does it. So, but I did go with a Rivadella like you did. I didn't look up at the selections. Plunging to this 12-5 level and removing the blinkers today after facing state bred allowance runners, allowance level competition with those blinkers on. It didn't work out. Taking the blinkers off, drop.
This is a serious class drop. No. This is a worrisome class drop for me. This horse was cut out to be pretty good last year, but if they're not winning, you have to figure out where you can get them to win, and this is as good a spot, if any, for this son of Adios Charlie. I think he is definitely the one to beat. The 1-4, the Gipper, has age on some of these. There's a lot of 3-year-olds in here. The numbers 4, 5, and 6 are all 3-year-olds. Add the 2 to the mix, so only the 1 and the 3 qualify as older horse status. For the Gipper, making the second start of the form cycle, he was in that last race we just showed you with Goiza, but you couldn't find him with a search warrant. I figure he needed it. He'll be better today.
Yeah, Edgar Zayas riding for Armando de la Cerda. Now, the 4th race in here, I have to put a little caveat out here that my family owns the number 4 for Bowtie Fair, my cousin Tom, and talked to Edgar, who rode this horse last time out, and he just couldn't get this horse to put his patented late run in. He just never got on track. And when Edgar came back, said, you could run this horse again tomorrow. He just never got a chance to run. And as you mentioned at the top of the show, which was so good with your ticket, somebody's got to have some form reversal in here.
Well, I mean, we have the same four horses, okay. Which to me, that's not really that surprising, right. Because some of the other ones, they have to have some severe form reversal. Right. At least these four, which one's going to wake up and how they're going to do it. But all of them have enough back class to win this race. It's just a matter of who trips out and who gets the win. For me, the tactical advantage and maybe the price advantage is with the 7, Whiskey 7. This is good old-fashioned horse training with a horse that ran 5/8 on the grass last time out. First start off the layoff, now goes two turns. That's the patented tune-em-up race last time out. Not a lot of speed in here. Jairo Rendon should be offensive-minded. I love this guy on grass, so I figure I'll take a shot.
Yeah, that's a good way to go, stretching out for Chuck Simon. So maybe, it was like that angle, stretching from a sprint to a route. But the sprint was okay. It wasn't great. So maybe the horse needed that race. And as I mentioned with Bowtie Affair, he has races on the go back that are good enough to defeat this field. Used to be the track record holder at the about 7.5-4 long distance here. A couple of starts back. I think this is when he first started running it. It didn't last very long. Bobby DeBona with Sammy Camacho in the saddle today. I think this horse can rebound there, but I got a sort of a family route there, and I split him with the Tropicat. He was dropping to the 12.5 level, taking the blinkers off after shipping down from Fairgrounds into the Ralph Nix barn and failing to fire against those 25 open claimers.
Yeah, and the other horse, there's horses to talk about, like you say, Tropicat, second start back in South Florida. He's going to be favored, maybe. I don't know. If he's not favored, I'm fine with him. The 3 Natural Order is 3-1 on the morning line. Man, I wish we could get better than that. I'd have a better chance with him. His form lines at Tampa are pretty good. He's running against some nice horses over there. Completely Bonkers, Adios, Nardo, Great Harbor K, Astute Warrior. Those are all solid grizzled campaigners. Nothing wrong with his form lines. He just needs a better trip. He does have some speed, so if LeBron wants to use it, he could be an upset possibility.
Yeah, and his record over this course is 5 starts, a win, a second, and a third. So even with the Tampa form, he's proven that he could run here on this turf course in South Florida. We'll go to race number 5 today. This one, 5 furlongs on the turf. Claimers 3 and up. Non-winners of 2 in life. I went with the 3 Cryogenic in here. You talked about you needed him badly last time out. I think he's primed and ready to score after returning from the layoff. He finished second at this level in distance. Ray Lou Gutierrez riding for Mike Mega. He looks like he's came down and ride, gets first call for Mike Maker throughout the afternoon.
Yeah, he texted me a couple of days ago, see you Saturday, buddy, and unfortunately I'm up here, so hi, Ray Lou, how you doing? back to Cryogenic. Cryogenic last time out, he was in a position to win, but the problem was that Victor LeBron taught Teak how to rate, and we had story time a couple of days ago. I shouldn't tell this story, but I will anyway. It's at least on me. I threw the program at the 8th pole of this race during the call because I was very much against Teak. I don't like that horse at all, and I couldn't believe he sat off the pace. Nevertheless, he was the best winner, and he was one of the favorites in that race. So Cryogenic should have needed it. We'll see if he can do the same thing today.
Terrence Cove, the one you have on top, as you mentioned, interesting. This one now in the Georgina Baxter barn. This is a $95,000 son of Tale of the Cat. The debuts on the turf. He failed to show much on the synthetic and the dirt out there in the Windy City area in Chicago.
This looks like a project horse to me. And in this race, the one dynamic dancer, at least for me, now this may be my own personal bias, he's not really that fast. I mean, he looks fast on paper, but maybe fractional-wise, especially sprinting on this turf course, he's not as lone speed or as run and gun as you think he is. With that in mind, I want to try to find somebody to get on his hip or maybe even outsprint him. And I figured that the 4, Karen's Cove, has a shot to do that. This looks like a project horse to me. He broke his maiden at Keeneland going special weight level at 6 furlongs. So he was cut out to be okay. His last races are terrible, but that's also why he's been laid up and dropped in. If the Baxter barn can get him ready, I think they can. This horse could be overlooked because you have to really dig to find races good enough to factor here.
Yeah. And I had a two-horse day, a little highly rated than you, and dropping to the 12.5 level, debuting on the turf, finished that sightseeing 6 behind that repeat winner.
Sightseeing 6. I like that. Can I use that to call?
Sure. The repeat winner was a leaky cup that day, 35 claimer on the main track. It's Victor Barboza Jr. with Summer Camacho.
Mark my words, I'll use that before the end of the summer. Horse is wide and 6. It's a sightseeing 6.
Sightseeing 6. See that, how it flows? Let's go to race number 6. 6.5 furlongs, claimers 3 and up. $6,250. Looks like the race goes through the number 5 scam.
Listen, He's 4-5 on the morning line. I'm not going to sit here and sing the praises of a horse 4-5 on the morning line, but just do me a favor. Indulge me a moment as we show you his last race and consider before we show it, and don't hit play yet, I just want to set the stage here. The field that he is running against when we hit play is at least twice as tough as he's going to run against today. Now you can hit play. You draw your own conclusions. You have to tell me that if he's beating a field twice as tough as he's going to run against today, how, with this effort, he loses today.
Yeah, it'd be really tough to lose. He's in a really good spot, and he's changing barns today. He's going to the Marcel Navarro barn after that claim, and once this race is over, we'll pop up a pretty nice stat with Marcel Navarro first after claim, and he just cruises to victory.
Well, and the horse that's second in that race, Be My Hero, if he was in here instead of Scam, he would be 4-5 on the morning line. So I showed that because I wanted you to see the game grizzled performance that he put in and then ask yourself, can he do that again? I think he can. I think he should. And I don't think we should be talking about it anymore.
Yeah, I'm just going to show the stat real quick, and then we'll go to the next page here. This one, he's really solid. He's 24%, 11 for 46. This is first after the claim on the dirt right here at Gulfstream Park. He's 54% in the money and only $1.29 return of investment, but pretty nice here. So Scam looks like the one to beat. Now, you did not single this one on your ticket.
Yes, I did.
Oh, you did?
I'm singling them on every one of my tickets. This is race number 6, my good man.
Oh, that's right. So
yeah, I wish this was part of the early pick 5. Yeah. Now, as far as who you use underneath, who cares?
Yeah, exactly. We'll go and take a break when we come back.
He didn't get it. I know there's some people out there who did.
We'll go take a break.
Whether you're at home or at the track, have a stake in the race when you bet with ExpressBet. Sign up for an ExpressBet online betting account and receive up to a $500 sign-up bonus.
Welcome back to Gulfstream Today. And now I get the who cares reference. Who was the horse I had second behind Scam in there? So I did not get it. The 7th race, 7.5 furlongs, claim is 3 and up, non-winners with 2 in life. And we got the Rainbow 6, which starts in race number 7. And my ticket is $48.
Ooh, all right.
And I'm ripping the Band-Aid off very early in here with the 3 strike play. He's dropping to the 12-5 level. Wesley Ward. Great stats, doing exactly what this horse is going to do. And I was looking at your late pick 5 ticket. Boy, the powder break could be one of the hardest races to handle. You could go 8 deep in there, and I can understand it. I went 3 deep. I got my long shot in there with the number 9, Quebec. 10-1 on the morning line. I think this horse has got a decent shot. I was looking for a little bit of a price. And I think the logical 3 in the last race are the 2, the 4, and the 9. I like the way the 9, Arpez, I think it's pronounced, on the outside. He ran a pretty good race last time. I mean, you think he's a little bit of a price on the board. I don't think he's maybe second choice or something like that. But it's just a great sequence. And the 9th race today, nothing to sneeze at either. That's a really good turf race.
Now, my question is, as it relates to your single strike play, do you think you're getting 5-1 on this horse?
No.
Yeah, no
I've
way.
Never thought that in the beginning, but I'm going, no way you're going to do that. And, you know, before strike play, I know you have some interest in a horse that, and when I went back and looked, because they sorted you pulled the replay, that strike, Silver Beach, excuse me, was talking about a sightseeing trip.
Yeah, I mean, this is the reason why I wanted to show you. Sometimes you can read something, and sometimes it's better to see it. Silver Beach and the Patricia Generazio Silks there. It's going to plot a pretty wide course going around the far turn. Not so bad here. And I don't know that it's necessarily Paco's fault. If anything, he probably did what he was supposed to do because he wasn't going to get through down inside. But turning for home, Silver Beach has to angle probably a lot wider than Paco would have liked. far wide, six, about six or seven deep there. You're not going to win races on this turf course doing that. You're just not going to, especially not at this level. So that's an alibi for his last race. It was a pretty good run, but, you know, there's some others in here, including your and my second pick, the Wesley Ward horse, who very well could get the lead from the outset and wave bye-bye.
Well, that was my thought process. Drop it to the 12-5 level after breaking from post 12 last time out, dueling for lead, fading against 50 starter allowance runners going a mile on the Keeneland turf course. I want to show you stat on Wesley Ward. Allowance to claiming on the turf straight out. He's 37%. He's 10 for 27. He's in the money 56% of the time and still a really good return of investment. So I just thought this horse on the drop with the speed was the one to beat. Had to single. Got to make my ticket affordable, 48.60. That was my thought process with strike play.
Well, and dare I say, too, is another alibi for him. He went 22-4 on the Keeneland turf course. Unless you're a graded stakes horse, you're not going to be around very long for that, because that turf course is a closer-friendly course, always has been, always will be. So you can throw that last race out on strike play and hope you get the race two back.
And then I used Alien Invasion, who you have in third. This is dropping. This one is dropping a notch. Counted some early trouble, steadied repeatedly in that race when finishing seventh against 16-2 lifetime claimers. Clean trip will help this horse today.
Big scratch of nine, Jago's Fire, by the way, if you're wondering why we're not talking about him. He's out.
Yeah, he's out now. I had him on the ticket, too. Source Control, I closed it out with. And I just thought it was a strike plays race to lose. We'll go to race number eight. And now this is where our final pick five of the afternoon starts. And I'm interested to see your ticket.
Yeah, it's not easy. It's a $50 play. I went deeper because I think you do need to go deeper. My single is not as strong. I wish I could have a scam-type single here. But I'm going to go too deep in the first leg. I'm going to try to beat Supery Dupery. I'm telling you what, folks, if the two Heart Ruling Head has any ability of any kind and any speed of any kind, he's going to have a major say in the outcome, because not only is there not much form to go on, there's also not much speed in here. So I'm hoping speed can be in the corner of the two. I'll use the three King Kingo on the turn back try. He has enough two-turn speed to be part of this race. I mean, he has enough one-mile speed to be part of this race sprinting. So we'll go there and hope we get by. I think the ninth race is a very, very good betting race, but I struggled to find how many. You could use a lot in here, I think.
Yeah.
I'll use the 4 Swagger Jagger, the 5 Up the Ante, the 6 Speed Franco, the 7 Second Mate, and the 9 Holiday Stone, all of which stakes quality runners. So I'll get one of those home. I just don't know who. Now, in the 10th race, I had to single somewhere, and the path of least resistance in this sequence to me was number 3, Bondetti. A couple of key rivals in this race are 3-year-olds. I'm still not ready for 3-year-olds taking on older horses if the older horse has form to go on. So I'll single Bondetti and hope I can get him to trip out. I'm 5 deep in the feature race today, the Powder Break, but I'm happy that I have the Nicoletti Longshot in Quebec. I also use the 5, Bitacora, who I'm high on, back on her favorite course. The 6, Hogan's Holiday. If I don't use her, she'll beat me. The 10, Fool's Gold, off of 2 good races here during the championship me season. And then how about the Florida Cup winner, Crown and Sugar? She'll be going for yet another win in the row. Antonio Gallardo gives up about 5 or 6 odds-on favorites at Tampa to come over and ride this horse for Darian Rodriguez.
Yeah, I put that horse second just because of the record up there at Tampa Bay. And in the last race, you went 2-4 in there. I like the 9 a little bit. I went 3 deep in there, but I just thought that the 2-4 or 9, 2 and 4 are the logical ones in there. Now, getting back to the horse you did not use in your ticket, the 4 Supery Dupery, is dropping to the 10 level on the main track after hitting the board in 1 of 2 20,000 sprints on the turf. A repeat of his last race on the dirt back on February 14th would crush this group.
You think?
I think.
Okay. No. That's fine. I wasn't sure.
I meant back, I think this horse is a big shot. I can understand you going with a first-time starter in here because it's that kind of race. King Kingo, for all the reasons you mentioned, I think you got to have on the ticket. You're getting a 10-pound of pressure there, dropping him, getting in light, cutting back, and they put a 10-pound bug on that horse. It looks like he's got to go.
You know what a horse that I might have missed, and I just want to say it out loud so when he wins I don't get harassed? The 11, Trini Alex, might have a look here at a big number because he split a field making his career debut, and he had a rough trip. He broke slow and was 5 wide. He's not on my ticket, but I would put him on yours if you're playing exactas or tries. Low-profile connections, he'll be 150-1, but he has a shot.
Let's go to race number 9 this afternoon. And this one, as you mentioned, he used about 27 horses on his ticket.
No, I used the 5. I used the 5 horses that are on the screen.
Okay. Mile on the turf, allowance optional claimer, 3 and up, or the optional claiming price, $62,500. This is a nice race.
Sure is.
Go ahead.
No. This is a good race, and good racing is not my forte. It has been and always will be in your corner. So
that's going with Speed Franco you went with there on top. Well, the number five up the ante is returning from the layoff and turning back to a mile. First race in setting the pace and finishing second. That was in the 9-furlong Grade 3 Saranac at Saratoga. It's Christophe Clément. It's a son of Smart Strike. We'll show you a stat on Christophe Clément. 180 days plus layoff allowance runners on the turf. He's 12 for 45, 27%, 40% of the money, 235. And that's tough to do when you're coming off a longer than six-month layoff.
I was going to say, thank you for showing that stat and talking about it before I asked you a question, so now I don't look like an idiot. Number five up the ante. To me, just maybe I thought the horse might need a race. But the pace in here is definitely in the favor of the five and the six. I thought Speed Franco, now do take note, there is a key rider change here. Jaramillo's not riding today. Angel Rodriguez gets the call on the six, Speed Franco. He had to need that last race, and he was running against Ticonderoga, who was so good going last to first. I thought it was a pretty good run to only get beat two lengths in there with the trip that he got. We'll see if I'm right. I'm probably not, because it's a good race, and I have bad history with those.
Well, Mike Maker does an excellent job with claiming horses, but anybody time you go in and you grab a horse for $62,500, there's something you like, and that's second mate. Then this one, he moved to his barn after the claim. Game outing at this level and distance. He broke from the outside. He rallied to finish second. Mr. Maker thought it was good enough for him, and go and grab this horse for $62,500. Relu Gutierrez, you know, I just thought that says something to me. I mean, am I reading too much into it? I don't know.
Well, I went on a tangent yesterday about why did Mike Maker give up on my point exactly, and I put him right in the winner's circle. So I got nothing to say. I do have one thing to say, though. How about the 9 Holiday Stones race two back where he got beat two lengths to Krampus and breaking the rules? You're going to tell me that if he runs that race back, he's not involved here?
Yeah, he's going to the allowance ranks. He was, third place finished in the Grade 3 Canadian. He comes back, he weakens, but it's behind Dr. Edgar, who I really like, and that's in the Grade 3 Appleton. So this one classes up beautifully in this spot.
I think 10-1 is not happening.
Oh, no. I don't even know that, but no. I did not know that before. Just really, this is like a wintertime allowance race
it
here.
It sure is.
So let's go to race number 10 this afternoon. 1 mile claimer, 3 and up, non-winners of 2 in life, or 3-year-olds, 25 down to $20,000. And Biondetti further down on my ticket. I know you had back-to-back second place finishes for trainer Barry Croft.
Yeah, well, here's the thing. And I guess I can tell you why I like Biondetti and why I'm singled him and take a shot at a couple others in the same sentence. Biondetti was second last time out behind Acor, who was dropping to a career low and freaked, winning by 9. Two starts ago, he was second to Portal, who would come right back and win. Now, those two races relative to the 6, Tactical Quality, who I do agree is one of the key contenders here, he was second last time out, talking about Tactical Quality, to Quasar Moon. Quasar Moon came back yesterday against a less-than-stellar group and ran terrible. So when you consider that it's a 25 claimer, that was a 3-year-old, straight 3-year-old claimer. Now he gets to run against Biondetti, who's been tackling older horses who are in good form. If I think the 6 is the key rival to the 3, and that's the delineation, now you know why I singled the 3 Biondetti.
Wow.
I knew you were going to do that.
Well, now, I need your help here.
Okay.
I need your help with Chase Runner debuting locally for Laura Cesaris, is how she says
Laura
her name?
Laura Cesaris. She does a great job, but this horse was suspected to win last time because there wasn't anything in that race. I like this horse a lot, 2 and 3 starts ago on the grass. Dropped in last time out. Everybody knew about the horse by then, but there was nothing in there.
Yeah, I mean, won by 14-plus lengths that day, and I closed it out with Russian Wine, who you have on your ticket, who broke his maiden on the main track at the 50 level, goes back to the dirty track. The action faded against 52 lifetime claimers going a mile in the 16th on the turf. I like him better on the dirt, and I like the spot they put him in for 25.
So do I. I think he's a sneaky, like to say.
Yeah. Let's go to race number 11. 1 mile on the turf. Phillies have missed 3 and up, 75,000 guaranteed to powder break. This could be a graded stakes race, and I'm not just saying that because we work here. This is one good race to bet. And, a horse that you want to show, Too Charming, one of 7 that could win here.
Yeah, and I just wanted you to see why Too Charming ran so bad last time, because you have a horse. Before we hit play, I want to set the scene again. Two starts ago, so the race before this, she went gate to wire in the Tropical Park Oaks. Three starts ago, she rallied from a bit off the speed while in the clear at Aqueduct. But she does her best work near the lead. Now, with that in mind, look what happens in the Sand Springs last time out. She breaks just okay, but then Javi's going to try to rein her back, and she's not going to really take too kindly to that. You'll see it right about now. She says, no, 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 no. What are all these horses doing around me? I don't like this. No, no. And then she was even off heels, and she's still fighting the rider. Right. That was the key part of it to me. I get if he's on her mouth early and she checks off heels and she doesn't like that. But then once she settled and she still was throwing her head around, that's an alibi for me. And that was the reason I showed it.
No, and that's good to show that, because you can see that horse did have some trouble in it, and it looked like it was very rank, wanted to get in up and then didn't want to be held back. And as I mentioned, I went with the number nine in here, Quebec, and this one, a grade three stakes place daughter of Into Mischief. Getting the blinkers back after returning to the Bobby de Bonobon, this horse was out for a while, comes back to her most accomplished surface today. She's had eight races, three wins, 3 seconds. She stalked the pace. In that race we just showed you, she got beat a couple of lengths. That was in the $100,000 Sand Springs. And I just thought at 10 to 1, I would take a shot with a horse. I was looking for a little price at Crown and Sugar. I don't know what to make of that horse. The horse looks fantastic.
Well, I got to tell you, I want to talk about Quebec myself, because that race that we just showed you, the Too Charming didn't make the lead, that had a major say in the outcome, because Valedictorian would win that race going gate to wire, and the reason why she did it was because Too Charming wasn't on the lead with her. I think Quebec actually probably gets a tracking spot behind Too Charming. She adds the blinkers. It's her second start back in South Florida. You know she likes it here. She had an alibi last time out. I don't want to jump on the Nicoletti bandwagon, because I'll make sure the axle's smashing too and we won't make it to the wire. But nevertheless, I like that horse as well. And the 12, Crown and Sugar, she's just good. There's nothing else to say about it. She blew the doors off the field at on the Florida Cup program at Tampa. The 12 post is no bargain, but on the positive side of things, not a lot of speed in here, Ronnie, so a Gallardo can drift over. I think he'll be about three wide at worst here.
Well, you make a good point now. You put on top Bitacoro, who needs that pace up front. This horse is always a slave to its pace, what's in front of it and how's it's going to run. So Bitacoro, certainly classy enough to come running late and win this race.
I love the way she ran last time out. She was making up ground on Crown and Sugar in that last effort, and it was over a course that she does okay on, but this is her home house. And I figured that alongside Value, alongside Jairo Rendon, wide open race. I'm going to use a bunch, but that's the one I like the best.
Yeah, and one other horse that we both have is the 10 Fool's Gold. And you get sort of got, I mean, you don't have, I have on the ticket just because of the connection.
Oh, I'm using her, though.
Yeah, it's Chad Brown in here and Fergirl Lynch trying to keep a record. She's never been beaten on the Gulfstream Park turf. Now, with that said, it's only 2 for 2, but she's run perfectly on here. And Chad thought enough of this horse to keep her down here for this type of race, this $75,000 stake. And, you know, I've done this 50,000 times, tried to beat Chad Brown, and it has not worked out a lot.
And how about the fact that we're talking about 5 and 6 horses in this race, and the last year's winner and a 6-time course winner, Susie B, is not on your screen.
Yeah, that's amazing. So let's go to the final race this afternoon, and it is the 12th race, about 7.5 on the turf, Maiden Claimers. And outside looking in, it's probably the logical horse in here.
Yes, but I want to say something. I think you missed one here, the 6, King Leonardo. Maybe not to win, but on the tries and supers. But let's go back and show you outside looking in's last race. And if you tell me that this horse can run this race again today, I think he's probably posing for the picture. This is his first start on turf in almost a year. He had been struggling to get the maiden diploma on the main track. I think he's better on turf after watching this. Jose Bautista is going to have the return call. The eventual winner of the race, Mon Chevalier, is on the lead here, but outside looking in, coming closer to him and making ground on the others. So all things considered, the horse that won this race was the 5-2 co-favorite. So outside looking in, ran well and did what he was supposed to do. If he runs this race back, how does he not win?
Yeah, I mean, I that's why I used him on my Rainbow Six ticket. I also used the 4 Looking Savvy. But on top, I had the number 9, who you have in fourth, Al Perez. This one, should be primed and ready to offer for more after returning from that layoff to finish fifth at this level and distance. Rohan Crichton, he's solid, making the second start back from a 45 to 180 day layoff. I was looking for a little bit of a press. I don't even know what odds he is in the last race, so I was just...
That would be a 3-to-1 shot, sir.
Oh, 3-to-1, so he's second choice, I believe, behind either the 4 or the 2.
The 2 is 9-to-5, yeah, the 4 is the third choice. Looking savvy, who takes a minor class drop for trainer Eddie Broom off a good run last time out. The second place horse in his last race, Rumson Rally, would come back to get the job done. Before we go, though, 6, King Leonardo, he will be the controlling speed in here. His races on the turf at Tampa, they're good enough to beat this field. Speed will be his weapon of choice. The question is, can he hold off a horse like the 2 or 4?
Well, that is how we see the action here on Saturday. We're about to get the ready for Pete Aiello to give you the scratches. Oh, that's right. He's here already. So we'll see that in a couple of moments. And have a good day, everybody out there. And we'll see. We'll be keeping records of how my boy Pete did today. And we'll come back. I'll know. I'll just feel his wallet. If it's heavy, I'll know you did well.
Yeah, if it's not, it's going to be empty. It's going to be feast or famine today.
Good luck, everybody.
The best chance for success begins with a solid foundation. At Hardacre Farm, early personal one-on-one care starts the journey to becoming a champion. Bred to leading stallions, our mares represent the highest standards. Hardacre Farm's signature in the breeding industry. Based in Ocala, Florida, breeder and owner Amy Tarrant has inspired excellence throughout her entire career. In your quest for success, start with Hardacre Farm. Breeding the champions of tomorrow.